I'm not a fan of eating oysters, but I am a fan of how they can help our oceans and coastal borders. 10 years ago, here in New York City, water levels reached nearly 14 feet above the average low tide level as Hurricane Sandy pummeled the Northeast, leaving at least 125 dead, millions without power, and $60 billion of damage in its wake. While we may not be able to do anything to stop hurricanes like Sandy, we can do something to help mitigate the destruction they leave behind. And the solution might be this little guy. Oysters, which are not only delicious, well, for some, and good for you, are also good for our oceans and coastlines. Structures known as oyster reef living shorelines can also act as a storm safeguard, and according to studies from the Gulf of Mexico, can reduce the energy of powerful waves by as much as 76 to 93%. But unfortunately, it's estimated that 85% of the world's oyster reefs have been lost. So I want to know, are oysters truly efficient at coastal protection? Are oyster nurseries easy to grow? And do we have enough oysters to install them around the world? Let's find out.
On today's episode of Can It Save the Planet, we're breaking down the unique role oyster reefs play in helping communities stay dry and save millions of dollars in storm destruction. I'm speaking with Kate Orff of Scape, a design-driven landscape architecture and urban design studio based in New York City, to learn more about natural buffers like oyster reefs.
It's important to advance projects like this to help rebuild those ecosystems wherever we can and as fast as we can.
And ultimately find out if oysters can save the planet.
Presented by Honda.
Oyster reefs used to be so prominent throughout the globe and especially right here in New York.
When Henry Hudson arrived nearly 415 years ago, approximately 220,000 acres of oyster reefs littered the harbor, which contained almost half of the world's oyster population. But with a cocktail of overconsumption, disease, and pollution from untreated sewage, which still happens today during heavy rainfall, New York's thriving oyster population was no more. 1,100 miles south of us is Tampa Bay. The resident oysters have also seen a staggering decline. In Tampa, during an 82-year period, 83% of oyster reefs were converted to mangrove habitats, with the shift attributed to climate-induced changes.
But this isn't just an American issue. It's one that is felt deeply across the globe.
In fact, there are now four continents and at least seven different countries reintroducing oyster reefs. Living shorelines, like oyster reefs, play an important role in coastal defenses, and they could be a lifeline as the proportion of storms reaching Category 3 to 5 is expected to increase in a warming world.
And if the changing climate is not what stresses you out, then let's talk about money.
One study estimated that human-induced sea level rise accounted for $8 billion worth of damage during Hurricane Sandy. That's where restoration efforts come in. Projects like Scape's Living Breakwaters aim to increase physical, ecological, and social resilience through oyster reef installations.
And with the help of the Billion Oyster Project, they're working quickly to soften the blow of future storms, all while creating a healthier ecosystem for our underwater friends.
To learn more about the Living Breakwaters Project and natural solutions like oyster reefs, I came to the Scape offices in New York City and spoke with Kate Orff, the founder of the design studio.
So tell me a little bit more about Living Breakwaters Project.
It's essentially a kind of a linear necklace of breakwaters off the shore of Staten Island that was hit very hard by Superstorm Sandy. Breakwaters are designed as a kind of a rock structure that are seeded with oysters and shellfish, and they work over time to help replenish and rebuild shorelines. They reduce the erosion that we see naturally. So Living Breakwaters would absolutely help because they would take that harmful wave action.
Kate says breakwaters are great for storms, but don't fully prevent flooding. So we need to connect the dots between onshore and offshore solutions to truly protect coastal communities.
We also need to climate proof our buildings and our infrastructure. Living breakwaters is basically a paradigm shift, keeping cities and communities connected with the water.
With the help of the Billion Oyster Project, Scape is installing oysters on their breakwaters to help accelerate the coastal restoration process and increase biodiversity in the area.
In addition to oysters, we also have these tide pools and the intertidal zones, so they're already full of clams and barnacles. So we've had many, many shorebirds sighted. We even had a bald eagle land on the breakwaters last week, a huge eagle. I was in shock.
What are some of the hurdles that you're still facing or even faced from the beginning?
This project faced many hurdles, and it really gave me a window into the kinds of hurdles that all of us will be facing as we try to implement climate adaptive infrastructure, cleaner energy infrastructure. This project, which is restorative and very positive looking, needed to go through the same kinds of environmental and permitting reviews than, say, a polluting factory would go through.
Although natural-based solutions might struggle getting past federal, state, and local laws, projects like installing oyster reefs do have the ability to scale up and be implemented around the world.
I definitely see that in different zones of the United States, and to be sure, around the world, some of these ideas could really lock into place and help make our coastline safer while building an awareness of the physical landscapes that we live in. We have something like 15 billion oyster schools now on shore on Staten Island. So there's already a kind of an upswelling of social interest, of connections around the waterfront.
As for how long it takes to grow these natural barriers, Kate says in 5 to 10 years, they're hoping to have a thriving oyster reef, one that is protective on day one.
I see this project as one of many, many projects that needed to happen 10 years ago. We are facing a moment in our history, which is literally ecocide combined with a climate-changed physical landscape. But in the meantime, there is not one day to lose because our coastal environments are rapidly disappearing, literally disappearing.
Got it. So oyster reefs have a lot of benefits, but face some challenges. I think we might have an answer though.
Before we get to our conclusion, I'd like to take a moment to thank Honda for sponsoring this episode.
In our mission to achieve carbon neutrality, initially the biggest part of that will be battery electric vehicles. But over the long haul, we believe as Honda that hydrogen fuel cells are really the ultimate form of clean and renewable energy. When Honda learned about First Element Fuel, what really attracted us to them was their mission and their ability to stay true to their mission to provide clean, renewable hydrogen as an energy source to the public. They're already operating multiple hydrogen fueling stations across California, and they're talking about making hydrogen available in other states and even other countries. We've been offering fuel cells for more than a decade already. The Honda Clarity fuel cell has already had 2 generations. We have exciting news coming soon about the next generation of fuel cells and the technology that will apply to that. Working at Honda, I've been able to drive every generation of our fuel cell vehicles, including the next generation, and there's no reason not to drive one. I love the peace of mind of knowing that the only exhaust is some water. My 7th grade earth science teacher had a piece of construction paper above the chalkboard that said the only constant is change. And no statement has remained more true throughout my entire life. Now we are beginning to understand the impacts of CO2 emissions on climate change. So we have to adapt. We can't just pretend that this next transition is the last transition, because it won't be. Everything will continue to evolve around us, and we want to be ready for that.
Now, back to the episode.
Let's do a quick recap of what we learned. Number one, oysters act as natural breakwaters in a storm and help lessen the blow from major storms. Number two, oyster nurseries are easy to grow and keep up. And number three, humans decimated these oyster populations, but organizations are working hard to restore oyster reefs around the world. So, can oyster reefs save the planet? Yes, but there's an asterisk. Now, the proof that oyster reefs can soften damage brought on by storms is there. There's also hundreds of millions of dollars being spent across the globe to restore oyster populations.
Even the military is working hard to install several oyster barriers across multiple states, investing millions to protect piers and airstrips. Local communities across the country are also investing millions. In one locality in Louisiana, state funds totaling $72 million are supporting the implementation of 18 miles of oyster reefs on concrete blocks in an attempt to curb land loss from erosion and storm surges.
Like I said, there's always an asterisk to this solution.
Elevated carbon dioxide levels in the atmosphere are causing more CO2 to dissolve into the oceans, and this makes the water more acidic. This stresses the oysters and makes it harder for them to build their shells and thrive. But as is the case with some coral species, scientists are finding that some oysters can be selectively bred to increase their resilience to higher ocean acidity. Then there's the issue of over-harvesting.
Restoring them can oftentimes feel a bit hopeless, but there's always things local coastal communities can do to get involved and help out.
It can be as easy as recycling the oysters you eat by donating them to restoration projects in your area. Those shells are then seeded with oyster larvae and later placed in a reef site.
Guess now I'll have to eat the rest of these oysters, or can I get some hot sauce or maybe just like a shrimp taco?